I get off at my stop. Squeeze past the other passengers with my portfolio stuffed with recent work. Find the building, scan the directory, and ring the buzzer for the gallery. I wait. Nothing happens. Maybe the intercom is broken. I push the button again, but this time harder, like when waiting for the lift. Finally, this crackly voice comes on the speaker and asks how she might direct my call. The lady in the speaker's confused. She thinks I'm calling from a phone. So I inform her I'm downstairs. Silence again, and the lady in the speaker asks me to spell it. I look around, thinking this must be a prank. I continue anyway, spelling my name slowly for her, shouting into the panel. Three obese drug dealers notice this, and they snicker and shout rude comments at me from the corner. Suddenly, the door buzzes open. I flee into the lobby and find the lift. I push the button repeatedly. It's one of those old warehouse lifts with a lever that looks like a blackjack. I'm not sure how to operate it. Guessing, I tug on the handle. The lift jolts upward, and the motor groans like the cable's going to snap. I reach the fifth floor. I push the handle, and the lift shudders to a halt. The door opens, and I'm staring into this immense space, like heaven or utopia with designer furniture. Everything is painted gallery white. A young Marilyn Monroe type is seated behind a sprawling glass desk, which is situated in the middle of this movie set. She's got a phone glued to each ear like a stock trader. This must be the lady in the speaker. After an uncomfortable amount of time, she notices me standing there. She shoots me a look like I just beamed down from space. My presence disturbs a fragile equilibrium, so she finishes with the phones and motions for me to follow her. She leads me down a dim corridor, narrow and wood-paneled, gas lamps along the walls. We come to a massive metal door, like on a submarine. She rotates a series of brass pistons. The door swings open dramatically. It must weigh a ton. Speaker lady motions for me to step inside. The door shuts behind me with a hiss of steam. I turn to ask speaker lady where we are, but she's not there. There is also no door, no wall, no sound, nothing. Lunar rocks and hills of gray sand stretch to the horizon in every direction. Everything else is black. The sky, the horizon, an immense black dome overhead. No stars, no sound, nothing. Breathing is difficult. I feel prickly all over, like bugs irradiated under my skin. A blurred figure appears in the far distance, yet close up. It moves slowly, like walking underwater. I see it, speaker lady. I call out to her, but nothing comes out of my mouth. She's moving toward an antique cabinet standing inside a curtain of dazzling blue light. I walk towards her, but each step takes an eternity. I look down at my legs, which are now gargantuan battleships. After many years, I reach the edge of the light. I look up, but I can't tell where it's coming from. I'm afraid to step into it. I'm sure it's what's killing the bugs under my skin. Speaker lady removes something from the cabinet. She turns to show it to me, but I can't see what she's holding. I slip into the sheet of light to get a better look. Suddenly, I find myself lying in a hospital bed. I'm hooked up to tubes and wires, various colors and fluids crisscrossing my bed. There are no walls, no ceiling. I hear the sound of my breathing being echoed by the thrumming whir of some apparatus. Beyond my bed is the gray sand and the black dome. They form a jagged line at the horizon. I sense someone standing next to me. The figure is shrouded in a burqa. The color is a sterile, cold, luminous white. I can't see who it is. Their face is obscured by a mask made of mesh. The figure lifts a syringe to the light. A tiny fountain squirts from the needle. The drops sparkle, all the colors of light, and drift downward like snow. Other white figures move around in the room, carrying trays of medieval medical instruments. A television hovers at the foot of the bed. A high tone bursts from the speaker, and the picture starts to scramble. The television must be broken. I turn my head to tell the nurse, but she's not there. The figures in the room are gone. The gray and black have become blurred. A cold blue beacon blinks on the horizon. I feel someone take my hand. I look down. Someone is sitting by the bed. I squint, trying to focus on their face. It is a woman about my age, wearing a tattered coat. She's crying, but there are no tears. There is no sound. Nothing. It's then I realize the person sitting there is me, and I am dead.